هيا على الفلاح
That I'm something, brother. He has a tat on his neck, now I have to respect him. He's been in the gym for a couple of weeks. I gotta respect him, bro, he's something. Or maybe because his car is worth $60,000, $70,000, so I'm kicking back, brother. What you looking at, bro? Who are you, man? You're nothing. Lam yakun shay'an mazkura. Allah says you weren't even in existence, bro. You didn't even exist. And you're walking around like you're something. Bro, your beginning was a nutfa. If you were on the floor, brother, I wouldn't have picked you up if you paid me. And we think we're something.
You know, my brothers, please, with all due respect, forgive me. But if you were to weigh your deeds right now, good deeds, bad deeds, which do you think scale would overweigh? The bad deeds or the good deeds? Brothers, enough is enough. Wake up, Ikhwani.
Statistically, it was proven many, many years ago, for example, the Daily Mail, or the Daily Express, they conducted a survey to say that the most well-behaved people in this society are the Muslims. That no longer stands true. The most worst-behaved people in society are the Muslims. And the official statistics of the prison has been noted that the greatest denomination of people on the increase who are going into prison is not the Hindus, is not the Sikhs, is not the other non-Muslims, but the greatest rise in percentage of inmates in this country, in Her Majesty's prisons, is the Muslims. These are facts collected by them. An increase of so many youth going into prison, and many of these youth come from an Arab background, and some of them come from the subcontinent background. They are illiterate regarding their religion. Even to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, they don't know how to recite it. They don't know the basic tenets of their belief. They're involved in all types of crime. And then we find the other extreme of other people involved in crime, and they feel that it is legal to rob people, it is legal to harm people, because they are just merely non-Muslims. They have no right, they have no sanctity. These are the two extremes that we are living in at the moment, which is a fact, that some are going to one extreme and the others are going to the other extreme. And we need to take the middle path and try to help our society and to correct our people in the wrong that they are involved in. And we find that from amongst the problems that the Muslim youth that they face, the problems of intoxicants, which is a clear taboo or clear shunning in al-Islam to stay away from the drinking of alcohol. And even if you study the advertising world and you look deep down into the logos and their slogans, and if you pay attention to them, you'll begin to reflect what are they trying to achieve. For example, you find the drink Heineken refreshes the parts other beers cannot reach. Carlsberg, probably the best lager in the world. Castlemaine 4X, Aussies wouldn't give anything else for it. Likewise, Jamaican rum or Malibu, the taste of paradise. These are all slogans that you find that these people, they portray in society. But these are the things that just a normal person, that these slogans remain in your mind as you grow up. Likewise, you find that the young people involved in music, where they believe that rave to the grave, live life to the maximum, do whatever you want to do. And now we find this new form of what they call gangster rap, which many Muslims, they listen to this. They feel that there's no harm in this. But the majority of crime committed in this country goes back to listening to gangster rap. Because why? Because this music portrays that if you want to be a person on the street, then you need to live by the gun and die by the gun. This is the motto, and this same motto is what the youth want to portray. Whether we want to accept it or we don't, the majority of Muslim youth in this area are in such type of crime and behavior. As for the believer, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him the perception, or her the perception, to see through all of these falsehoods. That the good and the bad will never ever be the same. Even though the evil may seem good to you, it may attract so many people. As for the mu'min, he sees through the perception that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to him. And he recognizes that this is something which is evil. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ يَا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ And fear Allah, O men of understanding. And this is something that we find continuously in the Qur'an. to come back to one thing, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. And we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created freedom in the human being to take what he wants to take and to leave what he wants to leave. As for the concept of freedom preached by the West, it has no bounds and no limitations. You go to whatever extent that you want. Continuously following your lusts and your desires is acceptable in society. So here you find that when society is not limited in its behavior, they like to mock at us that you believe in the concept of four women. Yes, we do believe in that concept, but it has been a freedom or a barrier has been placed there that we live within these limits. As for these people, they break all limits, all limitations, and they open themselves to whatever they want to do. This is a problem that was evident well before Islam and even towards the beginning of Al-Islam. And you read the lines of poetry written about the Arab community, they would only concentrate on a few things: the amount that they drink, the women that they entertain with, and the riding beast that they ride upon. This was basically their society. If we take that and bring that today, nothing has changed. The majority of mankind's discussion is about intoxications, about women and the fast car or the fast ride that they have. Nothing's really changed. The same fitna that was there at that time is the same fitna that is here today. So when people feel that, look, we are living in a time of fitna, they had fitna as well. The same temptation that we are facing was the temptations that they were facing. Yes, there may have been a slight change of parable and environment, but the temptations were basically the same. So we find that the companions asked. They asked you about drinking and gambling. So this was a question posed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So verily there's a big sin in both of them, in the taking of intoxicants and in gambling. And there's some benefit for mankind, but the sin is greater than the benefit that is within them. That the small amount of benefit that there could be in intoxicants here could be in the use of medicine purposes. Islam has laid down principles. It does not make one difference whether you drink one sip or a large barrel of alcohol. It is all forbidden. The person who compresses the grapes, the person who delivers, the person who serves, the person who sits on the table, they are all cursed. This is how harsh Islam is towards liquor and alcohol. So that is a clear warning to the adults in our society who run their off licenses, who run their fully licensed restaurants, selling halal food and then serving liquor, stating, look, we don't drink it, but we just serve it. It is haram. The hadith is clear in Sahih Muslim that 7 categories of people are cursed. The one who brings it to the table is cursed. The one who sits on the table is cursed. The one who compresses the grapes is cursed. The one who delivers it is cursed. So what doors do you have to open to say, we don't drink it, but we just serve it? And the majority of Muslim businesses thrive on serving drinks to the non-Muslims and to the Muslims. So how can we change society? And many of these people work in the masjid. Many of these people have influential roles in the masjid. Many of these people even control the masjid. Yet they run businesses like this. Do they not fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because this is the real misunderstanding of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But many Muslims feel that the taking of drugs is something which is allowed. This is a new form of intoxication which has come out in society, and it has been something that which they feel is allowed. So because the Sharia does not touch upon it, it's something which is allowed, and it's only something which is probably makruh, something which is despicable. This once again shows the lack of understanding of the Sharia. Because the ulama have written, Al-Khamr is whatever takes away your intellect. Then everything that is invented, which takes away your intellect, which makes your mind go, which intoxicates you, is khamar. Anything which makes you lose your mind, takes you in a form of hallucination, then that becomes something which is khamar. It is something which is forbidden. Why do you think the Muslim Ummah is in such of a destruction? That riba is rampant in the Muslim Ummah. Many times sins are mentioned, and he will mention that he is Ghafoor Rahim, that he forgives, and he overlooks and he pardons. But the sin of riba has been mentioned. Whoever takes riba, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his messenger, have declared war against him. And Ibn Abbas in the Tafsir mentions that these people who take riba, on the day of judgment, they'll be given weapons and they'll be said to them, fight against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But yet we find society trying to legalize these things. Muslim clerics trying to legalize it, trying to find a way, an opening to legalize it in society. And Muslim nations legalizing it upon their countries to allow people to indulge in such actions. Now, then we find some of the problems that we also find is any women. As we find the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam stating, the most pleasing things of this dunya which has been made good to me is good smell and women, and the coolness and the tenderness of my eyes has been placed in as-salah. So here we find a natural fitrah towards women, that a man has a lust towards women, but obviously Islam codifies it the way that we show this love and this affection. However, in this society we find that the more that women are exposed, that the more it becomes a temptation for people around them. So many of you may find they may not be indulged in intoxicants, may not be indulged in music, may not be indulged in anything else, may be upright men in society, but because of the allurement of women, they may tend to lean towards that type of behavior where they would begin to indulge in such actions. And we know that this behavior, this problem, has led to unwanted pregnancies, the breaking of families, running away from homes, because once again the masjid does not want to tackle the problems, the Muslim clerics do not want to tackle the problems, parents do not want to tackle the problems that they are facing, and just brush it aside and put it underneath the carpet. This is a fact that is happening, that such acts are being carried out in our society, that zina has become an acceptable part of society. And any nation that feels that abominable actions can become a part of society, then that society is going towards its own destruction. That if we no longer feel sin is a sin, we no longer feel some feeling in our heart that someone tells you that, look, I'm seeing some girl, or the girl tells you I'm seeing some boy, you feel nothing in your heart, then one should question their iman. There should be an ill feeling in one's heart. This is not the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created human beings, to show their desires in a manner like this outside the form of wedlock. So people need to once again to address the problems of the Muslim youth, open the doors of marriage, of counseling, of aiding them to become righteous people in society. And we find also from amongst the problems that the Muslim youth that they face is friendship. And this is something which goes back to the parents as well and society. To watch and to be careful of who they are friends with. Because we find in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a person is upon the faith or the belief of their friend. And Khalil is an intimate friend, a very close friend. Because you find various levels of friendship. So if your children, their intimate friends, are people of fisq, immorality, then know for a fact that a person is upon the way of his friend. Let one of you look at whom he takes as his close, intimate friend. And we find a very famous hadith as well, giving the example of friendship. That if you go to the perfume seller, if you don't buy the perfume from him, but just stand there next to him, one thing will happen to you, is a good smell will come upon your clothing or upon your body. And likewise, the person who is the ironsmith or the blacksmith, that if you just stand there, that some of the heat, the fire, the smoke, the sweat will come upon your garments and give you that stench. That is the example of friendship. So this is the example, as we find in the hadith, of good friendship. Destruction be upon me, that why did I take so and so as an intimate friend? This person took me away from the dhikr after it came to me. So how many people, young people, are upon righteousness in the beginning, and then because we do not monitor who they are making suhba with, who they are having companionship with, that they begin to fall off the track. And it's easy for them to turn towards the path of evil. And we find that this society promotes to take as many of the Muslim youth away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have acknowledged the most uprighteous people, the most truthful people, the most honest people, the most people holding the best dignity is the Muslims. We've lost all hope with our own society. Let us try and grab them as well. Take them away as well. Give them freedom. Give them expression. What is their freedom anyway? We had everything. We conquered and we ruled, and then we were trodden upon. And so were they. But there's one difference, as Ibn Khaldun mentioned in his Muqaddamah, that every nation has an educating time. It comes to a peak, it flourishes, it dominates, and then it's destroyed. Except for the Muslim Ummah. It will be destroyed and it will come back again. All other nations will be destroyed and perish and never come back again. Whether it be the Romans or the Persians or the Anglo-Saxons or the British or the Vikings, all of them, you need the empire where the sun never sets. Meaning that they rule over the majority of the world. And now it is all over. They feel that they still have some command over many countries, but that is drifting away as well. There's only one nation that will come back again, which has been proven inside the text, in the noble text, has been proven by the intellectuals as well. People like Samuel P. Huntington in his book, Clash of the Civilizations and the Making of the New World Order, he holds that the Muslims will come back again once again. People like this Chomsky as well, right, that the group that will come back again will be the Muslims. So from a textual proof, from evidence from the Quran, from the Sunnah, from the intellectual proof, that there's only one nation that will ever come back again, and that is the Muslims, and they will conquer. And there's two types of inshallah as well. One inshallah that you just say it, and there's one inshallah in Arabic which is known as tahqiqan, that it will definitely happen. And this is that inshallah, that Muslims will be victorious without a doubt. And this is all from the plot and the planning of Shaitan. Because at the end of the day, he is the one who calls towards such actions. He only wants to call you towards evil and al-fahsha. And al-fawahish is every type of immoral behavior. This is the handiwork of Shaitan. That really he is a clear, devout enemy to you. That I will come from the right, from the left, from behind, from in front of them. Attack them from all angles to take them away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find that he doesn't necessarily take us by the hand and take us towards sin. But he's whispering, especially to the youth, leads them to indulge such actions. And then he will state himself that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you a promise, and I gave you a promise as well. And I had no power or authority over you, except that I called you and you answered my call. Don't blame me, blame your own self. So even on that day, Shaitan is going to accept. He's going to say, all I did was call you. You responded to that call. Don't blame me, blame your own self. Because he knows he's on a one-way ticket to Jahannam. And the majority of these people in this society know that they are on a one-way ticket to Jahannam. And that's why you find that even the songs that they sing is, we're all going to hell, so let's all try to get there and make the most of it. These are some of the things that they believe in. And we find that all of this goes back to one thing, is the falling of one's lusts and desires. Many people feel that shirk is to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But to follow one's lusts and desires and passions is also worshipping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have you not seen the person who takes his hawa, his lusts as his desires, as a deity other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has covered his eyes, his faculty of seeing and hearing, and has placed a covering over his heart. And who is going to guide him after that? And will they not pay heed towards that? Meaning the person who follows his lusts and his lusts and his desires become an ilah, become a deity for him, become his god, becomes his object of worship. Because that is what ilah means. Whatever you worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of it is batil, all of it is false. Worship only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why you find these people, that what is this life except for living and dying? And the only thing that will destroy us is the passing of time. Rejection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically what they believe in. And we find that this taking of one's lust and desires, that the taking of dinar, cursed and wretched be the one who worships the dinar, the one who worships the dirham, the one who looks into clothing. That if the dunya, the materialistic dunya, the craving of wealth becomes so paramount in your life that you go to great extents to forget your deen, to forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then know that this is shirk billahi azza wa jal. This is also shirk. You are associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, leaving everything that you've been ordered to do to gain the small weight of the dunya and losing the akhirah. And what a wretched deal that is.
What is it that you want people to say about you after you die? Which means, how do you want to be remembered after you die? What is the purpose of your being? قل إن صلاتي ونسكي ومحياي ومماتي لمين لله رب العالمين. Say that my salah, my nusuk, my sacrifice, my life, my death, everything belongs to Allah. Do you live in accordance to the commands of Allah? Do you live in accordance with commands and the ways and the teachings of Rasulullah? I have created the ins and the jinn solely for this purpose, to worship me. Who do you worship? من تعبد؟ What dirham? What dollar? من تعبد؟ Who is your Lord? Be one, be you, be yourself, be genuine, be sincere, be honest. There's some people who have 1,000 faces. How many faces do you have? Be Abdullah, be the slave of Allah. Put your trust in Allah on one path, the path of Rasulullah. Which path have you chosen for your life? For your family, for your children, if you're married, for your wife, for your spouse, for your husband, for your parents, for your society. Which path have you chosen? Allah will ask each one of you, what did you do for my religion? What did you do for Islam? Question number two, message number two. Tell me who you hang out with. I tell you who you are. Who are your friends? Who are your buddies? Who do you hang out with? Who do you love hanging out with? Where do you love hanging out? Who are your friends really? A friend is a mirror unto you. If you were to look at your friend, you should see yourself. So who are your friends? The Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith reported by the Sunan, very sound. He says, a man shall follow the footsteps of his close friends. Let each one of you meticulously choose their friends. Who are they? That day, a man shall say before Allah, oh Allah, oh Allah, I wish. He will bite his hand and he will say, I wish I had fallen the path of Rasulullah. I wish I did not take so and so as my friend. But that day will be too late. Who are your friends? Are they those who care about you? They call you when they don't see you for Salat al-Fajr. They call you, they come to you, they say, Ya Akhi, are you okay? Are you fine? Are you sick? They care about you, not for what you have, but for what you are. Are they your friends? Who are they, Ukhti? Who are your friends, sister? Who are your friends, brother? Who are they? You have to meticulously judge them. Put them under trial. Test them, test your friends. And then select them. If you were to die now and you are sitting in the presence of your friends, would they be able to remind you to say La ilaha illallah? Those friends that you hang out with today, who are they?
So your mother, who loved you more than anything in this world, my brother, if you push the right buttons with your mother, she'll disown you, man. Your father, who took honor and pride and said, mashallah, this is my son, who used to hold you on his arms and hold you on his shoulder and wanted the world to see my son. You push the right buttons with your old man and he'll disown you, bro. How many brothers do we know that have been kicked out of the house? Your best friend, my brother, your best friend, the guy you grew up with when you were young, my brother, me and him, we're like that, bro. Yet you push the right buttons with him, my brother, and he'll disown you. You work for your boss for 20, 30 years, but even your boss has a procedure at work. He says, if you break this procedure, you're gone, you're finished. But Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who says, do whatever you want, my slave. If you come to me with repentance, I will forgive you. He says, my slave, if you come to me and your sins have reached the heavens, but you don't associate partners with me, I will come to you with mercy that matches it. He says, oh my slaves, those who have transgressed against themselves, never, ever, ever give up hope in the mercy of your Rabb. This is Allah. This is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. This is Allah. Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who between wudu and wudu, he forgives your sins. Between salah and salah, he forgives your sins. Between Jum'ah and Jum'ah, he forgives your sins. Between Ramadan and Ramadan, he forgives your sins. Between Hajj and Hajj, never mind forgives your sins. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, you go back to the day your mother gave birth to you. He says, oh my slave, if you come to me a handspan, I come to you an arm's length. He says, if you come to me walking, I come to you running. He says, oh my slave, when you remember me, I remember you. When you forget me, I still remember you.